start saying anything, a quick nod if the audio visual is all good. All right, so happy evening everyone. Before we even start with this session, so there's a news that the INICT 2021, which was supposed to be on 8th of May, has also been postponed considering the number of COVID cases that are increasing so significantly. So if we look at the larger picture, of course it is good for each one of us that we stay safe. That means at least we don't get our loved ones at risk when we go out to the examination center, stay there in the center for such a long time with so many people. So let us see the good in everything. Of course, everything happens for a reason. And as doctors, let us help everyone in whatever way we can. That is the best that we can do. So, yes, in the today's session, we are going to see some clinical MCQs. It's difficult to keep on track, especially for the students who are appearing in 2021. Even for 2022 students, it's becoming difficult, the uncertainty, when will they have their exam. But guys, studies, knowledge is something that irrespective of exams, you should keep doing it. It only adds to your knowledge, and you never know what piece of information you read sometime will come to your rescue in practice. So keep reading, so keep studying, keep revising and keep winning. As I say that, this is not the end of the session. I usually say that at the end, but today I'm saying this at the beginning of the session. And in the today's session, that actually we had special class at 9:30 p.m. where we are discussing the INICT recall questions. We are done with four subjects so far. Today medicine was planned. We'll do some questions probably, but not many. Planning to do something different in the special class tonight at 9:30 p.m. What is that special? Not decided. I'll disclose that on the Telegram group in a while. I'm looking for inputs from you guys as well. So to lighten our mood, to have that chillax session today, to relax a bit, we will have something different in the tonight's session. I know that you all have been going through a lot of stress, especially with the situations around. So we do deserve a break, some relaxation, right? So we'll plan something on that sense. हाँ, और हवन तो ज़रूर ज़रूर करना पड़ेगा फॉर दिस बैच हु इज सीइंग सो मेनी पोस्टपोनमेंट्स इन द एग्जाम. और आई थिंक यू गाइज आर सो सुपर ऑसम, सो वेल प्रिपेयर्ड दैट द एग्जामिनर्स आर अफ्रेड टू टेक योर एग्जाम, राइट? सो ऑन दैट नोट, लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द टुडे सेशन एंड आई होप टू सी यू ऑल इन द टुनाइट्स अनयूजुअल बिट डिफरेंट स्पेशल क्लास, लाइव क्लास एट 9:30 p.m. ओके. So let's start with our clinical MCQs. Before that, guys, especially now when you are finding it difficult to get back on track, the Unacademy Plus subscription will come to your rescue because you have structured batch which is going on for the NEET PG revision. Please join that batch because it's a live batch. It's very interactive. You can get your queries solved. You'll feel that someone is sitting next to you and teaching you. So make the best of it. Unlike the recorded platforms, this is the uniqueness of this. So what is going on the Plus subscription? Plus you have Iconic as well. The next 2022 students and the undergraduate students, they can take the combination of both Unacademy and PrepLadder. So we have started with a new batch for 2022 already, 21st April. We could not wait more ki bhai 2021 ka exam ho fir chalu kare. We have to do it. And the 2021 students, this is the batch that I'm talking about. It has started on 21st, day before yesterday. So not very late if you have not joined yet. You have high yield clinical scenarios revision, you have image based revision, and you have MCQ practice. Everything included till 30th of May. At least this batch will keep you on track till 30th of May. Okay, so yes. Absolutely, guys. The condition is really, really, really bad. We are, staying safe. We should be so grateful, so thankful. Like, if our family is safe, we are safe. I mean, we are really blessed if, if we are safe. So thank for that. You know, we should be grateful for that. And this is a new plan that we have come on Unacademy. 3 month subscription gives you an extra 1 month subscription. So make sure, limited time offer it is, so make the best of it, right? So just download the Unacademy app. To see you all at 9:30 p.m. with the special class, special class, the unique special class, to get some relaxation today. 9:30 p.m. download the Unacademy app, and when you are attending the session, if asked for a code, use the code Dr. Nikita Life. Okay, use the code Dr. Nikita Life. And this is the subscription. We have decreased the prices for the subscription as well. You guys can use my code while subscribing. So let's get back to our clinical questions. Not many questions, but few questions, but it will test our concepts. So let us get to the clinical questions here. So you have a 54-year-old male who comes to the emergency room with retrosternal chest pain. As I always say, read the questions. I was just telling you on the Telegram group, read the question, read the messages from the last line. Which of the following ultrastructural changes would most likely indicate irreversible myocardial cell injury in this patient? Which of these is the irreversible injury? Amazing, guys. So you all are very well prepared with the topic of myocardial infarction, infective endocarditis. We have discussed in our plus sessions as well, those Robinska tables, right, which is irreversible. Mitochondrial vacuolization is, out of all of this, is irreversible. When there is mitochondrial vacuolization, it means that the ATP is not going to be produced henceforth. This is just irreversible. So mitochondrial vacuolization is a irreversible injury. So that means the rest of them are your reversible injuries, right? Please read that table of MI, the changes, gross, microscopy, everything. It's very important. So remember, the lesson learned here is mitochondrial vacuolization is typically a sign of irreversible cell injury, and it signifies that the involved mitochondria are permanently unable to generate the ATP. All right? Yes. So this is your irreversible one that we have. This is the irreversible changes that we have. In the nuclear changes, pycnosis, karyolysis, karyorexis are irreversible. Okay, the detachment of ribosomes from ER is reversible. The clumping of nuclear chromatin is reversible. While the rest of the nuclear changes, they are irreversible. The rest of them are irreversible. Okay, so please remember, apoptosis, necrosis, reversible injury, irreversible injury is very, very important topic. Okay. So for all the links, I am sharing the PDF with all of you shortly, have been working on that. So you will get all the links handy for the sessions that I've taken so far, the plus sessions, the special classes, the YouTube classes. So one good thing that happened with postponement of exams, so you students, you candidates could get some time to help me in this project and get the list handy. I'll be sharing with you all shortly. All right. Next question. This is your next question here. Just that the question is lengthy, but actually the question is easy. Yes, Sunny, MI has been taken in the plus class already. The link is there in the file section of Telegram group. Pathology ke links dekh lena. MI ka link is there. What do you think is the answer to this? Just read the question. Last line, last second line will, what will help you to answer this question? Which of the following is the likely diagnosis? The point mutation results in substitution of glutamic acid for valine at your position 600, and you see that there is BRAF mutation, a protein kinase. Absolutely, we have read it many times. Very, very important. This is your melanoma, BRAF mutation, V600E, right? V600E, that is what they are telling. Glutamic acid, valine replacement at position 600. Okay, so valine replaced by glutamic acid at 600 position. Yes. So what were we discussing is, what were we discussing? Melanoma, right? So you have V600E mutation. BRAF is the gene which is responsible. So when you have the mutation in this BRAF gene, basically it causes increased proliferation of the melanocytes. It causes increased proliferation of the melanocytes, and that is what leads to your melanoma. What is the drug when the melanoma patients who are BRAF positive melanoma, what drug targets this BRAF mutation? What drug targets this BRAF mutation wale mein melanoma mein, which drug is given? Something starting with E, absolutely right. Very good, Soumya. So that is your vemurafenib, right? That is your vemurafenib. VE, that is your mutation. V600E, that is the mutation. Melanoma, yaad rakhna, vemurafenib. Do you guys remember the staging, you know, that we have seen for melanoma? Kaun si do staging hoti hai melanoma ke liye, depending on the depth? We had seen the mnemonics for that. Melanoma, do staging ya classification jo hota hai based on the depth. What name is it called as? What name is it called as? Remember melanoma, bahar and cutaneous. It is bahar on the skin and it is cutaneous. So bahar se it is Breslow and cutaneous C is Clark's staging, right? Breslow and Clark's. So integrate everything. Whenever you see a word that you have read before, have that active recall habit of what all have I read about this topic, right? So this is melanoma, BRAF mutation, very, very important. Now, if I ask you that if this patient had metastasis to brain, if melanoma has having brain metastasis, how will it look like on T1 weighted MRI? So let's integrate some radiology. On T1 weighted MRI, will it be hypo intense or will it be hyper intense? What would it be on T1 weighted MRI? Hypo intense or hyper intense? Hyper intense, right? Why? Because we have read that some of the few substances which are hyper intense on T1 includes a melanin. T1 hyper intense is melanin, is T1 hyper intense. Otherwise, majority of the pathologies you see are T1 hypo. So please remember, melanin is T1 hyper intense. Very, very important. All right. So this is your BRAF mutation, and it is involved in your melanocyte proliferation. V600E mutation leads to increased proliferation. Next question here, a very, very conceptual question again. Please read the question and let me know your answers. So 50-year-old male, emergency room, sudden severe headache, double vision and bitemporal hemianopia. He has decreased libido, mild headaches for a few months. As you are attending, he develops cardiovascular collapse and dies despite aggressive resuscitation. What will you see in the autopsy? What will you see in the autopsy? So you have sudden severe headache. So I see some students answering A and some students, majority, answering B. Absolutely, the correct answer here is B. That is your pituitary hemorrhage. Okay, that is your pituitary hemorrhage. Whenever we see sudden severe headache, the first thing that comes to our mind is subarachnoid hemorrhage. But when you see this bitemporal hemianopia, remember it is specific. It is seen in your pituitary lesions. Your subarachnoid hemorrhage will not lead to bitemporal hemianopia. Plus your decreased libido, mild headache since a few months, that points to maybe this patient has a pituitary adenoma since quite some time. And now because of the hemorrhage into the adenoma, that is your pituitary apoplexy. That is what it is called as. There is bitemporal hemianopia. Plus, what is the cause of cardiovascular collapse in this patient? What is the cause of cardiovascular collapse in this patient? Is it such a huge amount of hemorrhage leading to hemorrhagic shock? Is it the hemorrhagic shock which is leading to the cardiovascular collapse? It is not the hemorrhagic shock. It is basically pituitary apoplexy leading to ACTH being absent now. ACTH nahi hai, toh steroids nahi hai. तो बेसिकली दिस इज लाइक योर एड्रिनल इनसफिशियंसी दैट इज लीडिंग टू द कोलैप्स बिकॉज ऑफ द ACTH, यस द नो ACTH. सो दिस इज योर पिट्यूटरी हेमरेज और एपोप्लेक्सी. रिमेंबर बाय टेम्पोरल हेमी एनोपिया इज अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्लू फॉर योर पिट्यूटरी लीजन. इट इज अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट क्लू फॉर पिट्यूटरी लीजन. योर पिट्यूटरी हेमरेज कैन लीड टू SAH. इट कैन गो इन टू द सिस्टर्न सर्कल स्पेसेस एंड इट कैन प्रोड्यूस विद योर मेनिंजियल इरिटेशन सिम्टम्स लाइक हेड एक एंड ऑल. बट बाय टेम्पोरल इज स्पेसिफिक फॉर पिट्यूटरी. दैट इज वाई द आंसर हियर इज नॉट रप्चर ऑफ बेरी एन्यूरिज्म विच विल कॉज SAH. ऑलराइट. नाउ पल्मोनरी एम्बोलिज्म यू विल हैव द चेस्ट पेन, डिस्निया, टैकिपनिया, वो सब रहेगा. इस्केमिक नेक्रोसिस ऑफ पिट्यूटरी व्हाट इज इट कॉल्ड एज, व्हाट सिंड्रोम इज इट कॉल्ड एज? इस्केमिक नेक्रोसिस ऑफ पिट्यूटरी इज दैट इज बेसिकली योर शीहान सिंड्रोम दैट इज सीन इन द पोस्ट पार्टम फीमेल्स who present with inability to lactate. So that is seen in postpartum females. This is not your postpartum female. Acute congestive glaucoma, it will present with your eye pain, redness, all of those things. There won't be bitemporal hemianopia. Temporal arthritis classically presents with your headache and very important jaw claudication. This is elderly patient, but headache with jaw claudication is present in those cases, right? So this is your answer here is pituitary hemorrhage. ठीक है. Now this is what your pituitary hemorrhage is showing here. What are we seeing here is your this hyperdense area in the pituitary, right? The hyperdense area in the pituitary here that tells that there is an acute hemorrhage which has occurred in the pituitary. That is your pituitary apoplexy because there is hyperdensity. All right. And this is your optic chiasma close to the cella. Close to the cella, we have the optic chiasma. So any pituitary lesion will compress the optic chiasma and that will lead to your bitemporal hemianopia. We have already read about the visual field defects in one of the YouTube sessions. So please watch that session. The visual field defects we have already discussed. So this is how it looks like your bitemporal hemianopia due to compression of the optic chiasma. Very important cause is your pituitary lesion. Very important cause is pituitary lesion. All right. That was not T1 weighted, guys. What image is this? Is this a CT or is this a MRI? What is this? Ye CT hai ki MRI hai? You can see that the bone is white here. The bone is white. So this is basically your CT scan. It is not your MRI. Okay. This is a CT scan. Yes. Next question here. Let us go to the next question now. So you have a 28-year-old woman brought to the ER, severe abdominal pain, right lower quadrant and vaginal bleeding. Severe pain, vaginal bleeding. LMP was 7 weeks ago. Past medical history significant for PID, hypothyroidism and appendicectomy. Blood pressure 80/40, pulse is 130. She is pale, extremities are cold and clammy. What will the endometrial curettage in this patient most likely reveal? What do you think is the answer to this? What will the endometrial curettage most likely reveal here? Please read the question very, very carefully. Is it C or is it B? Is it decidualized endometrium or decidualized endometrium with chorionic villi? Which of these? Whenever you see a reproductive age female with LMP amenorrhea, there is lower abdominal pain, vaginal bleeding, and she has come with symptoms of shock. There is hypotension and there is tachycardia. Always think of your ruptured ectopic. Okay, always think of your ruptured ectopic. Important history, why did this female develop ectopic? When there is a history of PID, it's a risk factor for ectopic. PID increases the risk of ectopic. So that history is important there. So this is your ectopic. This is not your intrauterine pregnancy. So the ectopic pregnancy also has beta HCG that leads to your decidualization, but there will be no chorionic villi. Chorionic villi will be present in your intrauterine pregnancy. Decidualization will still be present because you have increased beta HCG. So the answer is B, the answer is not C. Read the options very, very carefully. Okay, read the options very carefully. Endometrial inflammatory infiltration means it is endometritis. There will be no endometritis here. Atypical endometrial cells, multiple mitosis means it is CA endometrium. CA endometrium is more common in your postmenopausal female, not a 28-year-old woman, and they present with vaginal bleeding. We have discussed the staging of CA endometrium, CA cervix, CA breast, right on the Plus platform. Please watch those sessions. So ectopic is important here to identify the ectopic. One clue on ultrasound. When we do ultrasound, what is an important clue to tell us that this could be ruptured ectopic? We have discussed this in our integrated OBGY radiology sessions. So when the ectopic ruptures, basically it leads to fluid everywhere. So we will see free fluid in the POD. If the fluid is huge amount, it can be seen in the Morrison's pouch, and the free fluid will have ECOS. Why will it be ECOS? Because it is a hemorrhagic fluid, because it's a hemorrhagic fluid, right? What are some signs on ultrasound in ectopic pregnancy? You can get the ring of fire sign on Doppler. The ring of fire sign on Doppler, that is the increased peripheral vascularity. And you get the tubal ring sign, right? You get the tubal ring sign, which is very, very specific. So what do we see is surrounding the ectopic, we have this echogenic ring. Surrounding the ectopic, we have an echogenic ring. So tubal ring sign is very, very important, and it is very specific for ectopic. Okay, and it is very specific for ectopic. And that is about your ectopic pregnancy. Okay, that is about ectopic pregnancy. Next one, let's go to the next question here. A 10-year-old male with diarrhea and a low-grade fever is diagnosed with Shigella infection. Sigmoidoscopy shows inflamed colonic mucosa with ulcerations. Which of the following cells are primarily responsible for the uptake of Shigella that initiates the infection? So basically, Shigella enters into the intestine wall by which cells, through which cells? Is it epithelial absorptive cells, antigen sampling M cells, goblet cells, Paneth cells, or is it your PMN or endothelial cells? No. So let us see the functions here. Goblet cells basically secrete the mucin. Paneth cells are basically the ones which are responsible for killing the organisms. They produce your lysozymes, not lysosomes, they produce lysozymes. Polymorphonuclear cells will come in the inflammation. Endothelial cells, we discussed in the yesterday INICT microbiology recall me. Which E. coli acts on the endothelium? Which E. coli acts on the endothelium, and that is how it causes your hemorrhage, the hemolytic uremic syndrome? O157H7 wala, right? Wo dekha tha, the entero invasive tha, kaun sa tha? Entero hemorrhagic E. coli, right? Your EHEC, because it is causing hemorrhage, so it affects the endothelium. O157H7, similar to Shiga toxin. So this is the answer here is your antigen sampling M cells. M cells are basically your microfold cells. So when you see the intestine, you have the M cell through which this Shigella enters. It is through the M cell. This M cell takes the antigen, the bacteria, basically to the macrophages. But after this, the Shigella spreads to the surrounding intestinal cells. And as it goes down, it causes the necrosis and ulceration in the intestinal mucosa, and that is how it causes bloody diarrhea. That means it causes your dysentery. All of you remember, how does Shigella toxin act? Shiga toxin is 60S, right? That is how we remembered. So 60S, basically it inhibits your protein synthesis. Okay, that is protein synthesis. Yes, that was vascular endothelium. Here also, when we say endothelial cells, it is basically your vascular endothelium. So this is not the correct option at all. The answer here is your antigen sampling M cells. Remember, it is antigen sampling M cells. We yesterday saw in the INICT recall question on cholera toxin. Cholera toxin, what does it disrupt? From where does it enter? You have the zoonotoxin, zonula occludens, right? It is zonula occludens which it affects, the cholera toxin, okay? And this is your M cells, antigen sampling M cells, all right? Let's go to the next question now. Where do we have the next question? All right. So, autopsy of a 21-year-old male shows extensive atrophy of basal ganglia and increased brain copper content. There is increased brain copper content. The main mechanism of excess copper removal in the healthy human body is which of the following? How is the excess copper predominantly removed in the healthy human body? Absolutely. That is your hepatic excretion into the bile. The major one is your hepatic excretion. It is not your renal or intestinal. It is your hepatic excretion into bile. So when your copper handling with the body is affected, yes, that is what leads to the Wilson's disease. And Wilson's, may we know, the liver is affected. That means liver has a significant role in your copper metabolism. So copper, the copper which we eat, it is absorbed, it goes to the liver, it forms your ceruloplasmin, right? It forms your ceruloplasmin and it goes into the plasma and into the bile. So you have predominant excretion into the bile is very, very important. Yes, the gene responsible for Wilson's disease is your ATP 7A or 7B. 7A or 7B. It is your ATP 7B. It is the ATP 7B which is affected. How do we remember? Sun is beta. Sun and beta, they go together. Sun matlab beta. So this is ATP 7B. And what is the chromosome number? What is the chromosome number? Wilson's ka chromosome number? Wilson and Burka. If you have attended the plus classes, we have had session on genes and chromosomes and inheritance pattern. Please watch those sessions. You'll be able to solve many questions with those sessions. Wilson and Burka are present on chromosome number 13. Chromosome number 15, we have the family. Right, the son, the daughter, the father and the mother. Wilson wahan pe nahi aata hai. Yes, it is chromosome number 13. So you have BRCA, Wilson's, retinoblastoma on chromosome number 13. Theek hai? Wilson's mein in your MRI. MRI mein kaun sa sign dikhta hai Wilson's mein? What sign do we see in Wilson's in MRI? Wilson has a face like giant panda. Right, so face of giant panda sign, face of mini panda, cup panda, double panda, jo bhi panda hai, basically remember, Wilson is a person who has a face like panda. So that is face of giant panda sign is seen in the Wilson's disease. All right, let us go to the next one. Of course, all of you know that KF ring rehta hai, a very, very commonly given image in your exam. KF ring is seen in Wilson's, right? KF ring is seen in Wilson's. Next one. So what did we learn in this question is absorbed copper forms your ceruloplasmin, which forms your circulating copper. Senescent ceruloplasmin and the unabsorbed copper, they go into the bile and it is excreted in the stool, which is the primary route for copper elimination, for the excess copper. All right. This is Wilson's disease. Yes, sab pata hai humko. Let's go to the next question here. So this patient most likely suffers from which of the following? 75-year-old male, vision problems, MRI reveals multiple small lobar hemorrhages, right occipital and left parietal. Past medical history, evaluation 1 year ago, there was sudden right arm weakness. MRI demonstrated a small lobar hemorrhage in the left frontal area. This patient most likely suffers from which of the following? Do you think this is hypertensive encephalopathy? So yes, the only confusion that we have here, the only confusion basically what is given ki multiple hemorrhages ho rahe hai. Pehle bhi there is one episode of hemorrhage. And these hemorrhages, most important remember, are the lobar hemorrhages. So basically this patient has recurrent multiple lobar hemorrhages. So basically this patient has recurrent multiple lobar hemorrhages. And this is an elderly male, 75 year old. So this is definitely telling you that this is cerebral amyloid angiopathy. This is amyloid angiopathy, which is basically seen with increased age. Nothing to do with your systemic amyloidosis. Your hypertensive encephalopathy, your most common site of hemorrhage is your putamen. Basically the basal ganglia. That is the most common site. Putamen pons mein ho sakta hai, but lobar hemorrhages nahi hote hain. So this is your elderly patient with multiple lobar hemorrhages is classically your amyloid angiopathy. Carotid artery atherosclerosis, cardiac embolism, hypoxic encephalopathy, all of these will cause basically your ischemic strokes, not hemorrhagic stroke. Where the blood supply is affected, that would be your ischemic stroke. Hypoxic encephalopathy will first affect the areas which have minimum blood supply, that is the watershed zones in the brain, right? The watershed areas will be affected first, right? So remember that this is your answer. Saccular aneurysm will lead to subarachnoid hemorrhage, not lobar hemorrhages. Charcot-Bouchard aneurysms, they are basically seen in patients with hypertension. They are seen in patients with hypertension. Okay, so lobar hemorrhage means the hemorrhage in one of the lobes, frontal, parietal, occipital, temporal. It is located in one of the cerebral lobes and not in the basal ganglia. That is what is your lobar hemorrhage basically. All right, everyone understood why the answer is cerebral amyloid. Elderly patient, recurrent multiple lobar hemorrhages, think of amyloid angiopathy. So because of the amyloid deposit with increasing age in the vessel wall, the vessel becomes weak and the vessel gives away and it leads to multiple hemorrhages. Okay, and it leads to multiple hemorrhages, right? So this is what we have learned here, that cerebral amyloid angiopathy is a common cause of recurrent lobar hemorrhage, and it has a a lower mortality rate and your more benign cause than the hypertensive hemorrhages. So this is what is your lobar hemorrhage. It is in one of the lobe. This is your areas of blooming that we call in MRI. This is what we call as areas of blooming that tells you that these are hemorrhages. Okay, these are hemorrhages. Elderly patient. Yes, let's go to the next question now. This is the next question here. Which of the following processes is most likely to be responsible for this patient's back pain? This is a 76-year-old man. 76-year-old man, back pain. Whenever I start reading this question, like a candidate in the examination hall, either I think of multiple myeloma or maybe prostate cancer ke metastasis. 76-year-old man diya hai, so I'll think of these causes first. So comes to the physician complaining of progressive lower back pain. Pain is constant and nagging, bad at night, interfering with sleep, not relieved by rest or even with position changes. He also complains of urinary urgency, nocturia, frequency, hesitancy, and he has only hypertension. Which of the following is most responsible? It is neoplastic. When you have an elderly male patient, basically you have elderly male with back pain and with urinary complaints, that is telling you prostate enlargement, that is your CA prostate with your vertebral metastasis. It is CA prostate with vertebral metastasis, and these are your osteoblastic metastasis, right? These are osteoblastic, please remember that. And your neoplastic back pain, the vertebral metastasis, will not be relieved by rest or position changes. Your inflammatory back pain, when is the inflammatory back pain maximum? like ankylosing spondylitis. Inflammatory is more worse in the morning. Here you have it is at night. It is especially bad at night, not in the morning. So morning may it is very bad, the inflammatory pain. Degenerative wala is relieved with rest. Degenerative means it is, you know, becoming old. Do not give too much stress on that. Give some rest and the degenerative will be well. Here it is not relieved by rest, so this is not degenerative. Infectious will have associated fever with it generally. So this is also not there, and this is definitely not psychogenic. So this is your neoplastic. This is your neoplastic. What ultrasound can we do to look at the prostate better? What ultrasound can we do to look at the prostate better? Your transrectal ultrasound. Your transrectal ultrasound. If we have some suspicion, we can do a transrectal ultrasound guided biopsy as well for the prostate lesion. What is that criteria that we use for prostate cancer? MRI pe karne ke liye, we use PI-RADS, right? We use PI-RADS. That is your prostate imaging reporting and data system. PI-RADS is based on MRI assessment of the prostate. You have T2 weighted MRI, you have diffusion weighted MRI, and you can combine it with dynamic contrast enhancement. What is not included in PI-RADS is your MR spectroscopy. This is your previous JIPMER exam question. Which of the following is not included in your PI-RADS? MR spectroscopy is not included. Okay, MR spectroscopy is not included. So that is about your prostate cancer. Very, very important. Back pain, elderly male, urinary complaints. Next question here. Let us have a look at the next question. So which of the following renal structures are most likely to demonstrate the signs of ischemic injury? So we know that there is some ischemic injury, and 54-year-old male, acute MI, cardiac arrest, resuscitated, but next day urine flow decreases, creatinine is increased, and you have muddy brown cast. We recently had a session on the urinary cast. Very, very important. Muddy brown cast are seen in classically, they suggest your muddy brown cast suggests your acute tubular necrosis. It suggests your acute tubular necrosis. Why has the patient gone into acute tubular necrosis? Because of the decreased blood supply. Because of the MI, there is decreased blood supply to the tubules, the renal tubules. So ATN. So basically they are asking you which of the following will be first affected in ATN. Pura tubule jayega, but sabse pehle kaun sa jayega? It is the proximal tubules. Why the proximal tubules? Because it is located in the outer medulla. You have the glomerulus, you have the PCT, you have the ascending limb, descending limb, and the thick ascending limb. So these parts, the PCT and thick ascending limb, they are located in the outer medulla, which have the minimum blood supply. So whenever the blood supply is compromised, the first ones to be affected are PCT and the thick ascending limb of loop of Henle. These are the first ones to be affected. Okay, these are the first ones, right? Absolutely, like the watershed areas. So whenever it is affected, these are the tubular parts which are affected first. All right, so this is your ATN. Okay, this is your ATN. Next question here. Let's go quickly to another question. So you have a 54-year-old male and you have motor vehicle accident, skeletal injuries, his right leg is immobilized for several weeks and its diameter decreases for 2 cm over that period. A similar pathologic process can be observed in which of the following? So the last question for the session, when to suspect renal papilla? Okay, so renal papillary necrosis jo hamara option tha, renal papilla is when you have your postcard wala mnemonic. Your analgesic abuse, tuberculosis, diabetes, mellitus, sickle cell anemia. These are the ones which are common causes of papillary necrosis. Radiology may we have read the signs in our radiology sessions. You have ball on T appearance. You have lobster claw sign. You have signet ring sign. All of this we have seen in radiology, right? So papillary necrosis will come in those cases. All right. Kahan tha? Let's get back to the question. Which of the following will show a similar pathologic process? What is the process that they are talking about? What process are they talking about here? So after the accident, limb is immobilized and that leads to decreased diameter. So this is basically your atrophy happening, right? This is basically your atrophy happening. So atrophy or kis mein ho sakta hai yahan pe? Heart muscle during long standing hypertension. So if this is the heart muscle, you have the hypertension here, it will cause the hypertrophy. The back pressure changes will cause hypertrophy, not atrophy of the heart. So this option is out. Esophageal mucosa upon repeated acid exposure, GERD, Barrett's esophagus, that is a example of metaplasia, not hypertrophy. It is your intestinal type of metaplasia. This option is gone. Lung tissue after prolonged tobacco smoke exposure. Again, there is metaplasia. It becomes neoplastic. Adrenal glands during the prolonged corticosteroid therapy. They will undergo your atrophy. Because we are giving prolonged steroids. So the adrenal ka function is taken up by the external, the exogenous steroids. So adrenal se, agar aap bahar se steroids le rahe ho, so there is no need of me. So better I will take rest, I will involute and there will be atrophy. So adrenal glands ka function is taken up by the exogenous steroids and that is why the adrenal glands, they become atrophic. So whenever we give external steroids, the adrenal glands, they are rather suppressed, okay, because the steroids are doing the function. So the answer is your D, that will lead to atrophy. So remember guys, this is the same thing that can happen with our brains as well. With the postponement of exam, if you will not read for a long time, if you will take a long break, there might be some brain atrophy which might occur. So don't let that happen, okay, don't let that happen. Take it like the example of heart muscle during hypertension. Rather than atrophy, let it go into hypertrophy. The resistance that you are facing to give your exam, that increased resistance, let it lead to hypertrophy and not to atrophy. And I don't want even this to happen. Adrenal glands, so you are getting exogenous, all the ready-made material. I am giving you all the sessions, ready-made questions. So even that will lead to your brain atrophy. So do not just have passive studying, ki just watching the sessions. Have some active studies, have some self-studies as well. So let us go into hypertrophy and not into atrophy, be it disuse atrophy or be it the external replacement for your studies, be it me or any other educator, right? So hypertrophy ke taraf chalte hain. Aaj to break banta hai thoda sa. So as I told you, tonight 9:30 p.m. in the special class, the live class, free live class, 9:30 p.m. we are planning to do something special. So this is a special class, okay? This is a very special class where I basically intend to make you guys a bit relaxed and lighten the mood that, you know, we all are upset and disheartened. And yes, so I am looking for inputs from you guys as well to give me suggestions. Kya alag kar sakte hain, kya unique kar sakte hain. Agar, so get your brains into thinking, get some creativity out and let me know some suggestions on that. Okay, so whenever you are joining for the special class, use the code Dr. Nikita Life to join the class. Alright, so see you at 9:30 p.m. on the Unacademy app with a special class. Till then, goodbye, take care. Keep studying, keep revising and keep winning. Yes, that's the alarm which has rung there already. So, chalo bhagte hain and let's take a break.